The Americans have retreated to Brooklyn Heights. Facing them is the British Army. At their backs is the East River. Almost the entire Continental Army is trapped. The British wait for Washington to surrender.
In the 18th century, in European warfare, it wasn't just a question of winning, but it was also a question of how you won. In a way, it was better to lose well than to win badly. That was they thought the form and ritual of warfare was very important, and wished to behave like gentlemen at all times.
According to the gentlemanly rules of warfare, Washington should concede defeat. Instead, when night falls and a thick fog blankets the East River, he orders his troops to keep all their campfires burning. Then, quietly, he begins to ferry men, horses, and cannon back to Manhattan, a few boatloads at a time. By morning, the entire American army has crossed over to New York.
And the British finally discovered that the fortifications were no longer occupied. They rushed through down to the bank just as the last boat was pulling away. And the last man in the last boat was George Washington.
The British are stunned.
Washington should be very grateful to General Howe. What a kind enemy we are. Instead of crushing the frightened, trembling enemy at once, he generously gives him time to recover from his panic and regroup. 20,000 of our best men stand on the banks of the East River, like Moses looking at the Promised Land, with the rebel flags waving insolently in the air. The troops and officers couldn't believe that they were just standing there, not doing anything.
The American army may have escaped capture, but the British now occupy Brooklyn Heights. Their guns are trained on New York. Washington realizes that the city cannot be held. His soldiers grab everything they can, including the city's church bells, to be melted into bullets, and begin a retreat up Manhattan Island. The British move in to occupy New York City.
You can't imagine the joy of the city's inhabitants when we march in. Pure bedlam. They carry the king's officers on their shoulders. A woman pulls down the rebel's hated flag and stamps on it with contempt and indignation.
Most New Yorkers are fervently loyal to England, not to the revolution. Indeed, about one-fifth of the entire American population will remain loyalists throughout the war. They must keep their political views to themselves in areas where patriots are in control. But here in New York, it is the supporters of the revolution who must keep quiet or leave.
We have fled. It was raining and thundering so hard we had to stop by the side of the road all night. When we did find a place to stay, all we got was a dirty bed on the floor. It's very hard for us that are used to living comfortable.
Travelers will carry the accounts of the disaster in New York along the dirt roads and rivers of 18th century America. It will take over a month for the news to spread to all 13 states. Near Boston, an anxious Abigail Adams writes to her husband John in Congress in Philadelphia.
My dearest friend, there are so many rumors flying around that it is impossible to know what to believe. Did you think that we would be able to hold on to Long Island? If we could not hold Long Island, are they going to take New York City? And if they hold New York, will they be able to cut off New England from the rest of the colonies?
My best friend, I assure you that we in Congress are as much at a loss to understand what happened in New York as you are. In general, our generals were out-generaled on Long Island. Every time our militia see the British, they very courageously panic, turn their backs, and run away. Our Massachusetts men behave just as badly as everyone else.
As the British move in to occupy New York City, the Continental Army continues its retreat up through the countryside of Manhattan Island. It is not an orderly withdrawal. Troops that Washington has positioned to protect the rear of his fleeing army are themselves running at the first sight of British guns. Washington explodes into a rage.
It's one of the few times he really lost his temper. He threw his hat on the ground, he was on horseback. He yelled at them, screamed at them, he had his horse whip, and he was actually whipping some of the officers as well as the men, and finally he just gave up. All of this terrible pressure and disgust on him, he just sat there limply with Hessians coming at him just 80 yards away. And at that point, one of his aides-de-camp grabbed his horse and led him away.